Hello everyone, today is our 21st Dialogic Pedagogy podcast, and our topic today is what is the relationship between dialogic pedagogy and democratic education, that is sponsored by me a long time ago. There were eight people altogether voted for that, so we will do this podcast. This time it's only Eugene Matusov and me, Anna Marjanovic-Shane, and whoever join us, we will try to answer your comments, questions that you will send us and discuss this topic. So let's start, Eugene.
Well, I think we should start with you since you are sponsored the topic.
Yes.
So what you would like us to discuss?
Well, I would like to discuss several issues because dialogic pedagogy and democratic education definitely have a lot of the points that they touch each other and also various differences. So, for instance, I think that the issue of how much the student can influence and be participant in their own education as a equal as a participant with equal rights is something that maybe is an issue to discuss. What does it mean, and is there any difference between dialogic education and the democratic dialogic pedagogy and democratic education in that sense? How much the students and everybody who participates in that process have equal rights?
I'm not sure I understand fully equal rights. It's just because not very clear for me, but I think let's us probably discuss first what democratic education and then maybe compare them how they similar and close, and then maybe come to the questions that you have, which I'm not sure fully understand the question. So what's democratic education? How you understand democratic education?
Well, democratic education I first encountered in a book on Summerhill.
What Summerhill?
Summerhill is a school in England that was founded by A.S. Neil, first in Germany, and then just before the Second World War, he transferred it to England. It's a school, it's a boarding school, first of all. Boarding school in which children and their teachers or staff members live together and organize their life together fully. And it's democratic in the sense that they all participate in making all decisions about their lives together there, including their education.
Mm-hmm.
So that is, there are no pre-organized classes on any subject, but if there is such a need that is expressed by some students, the classes may be organized and offered. The students can influence their schedule, when they want to study and with whom they want to study, in many different ways, age or friendship or gender or whatever.
But I think the main core is not what you just said. The main core is that whether to study.
Whether to study at all. That's the main core also.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And also you said first of all, so
yes,
second.
The second, then this whole approach.
No, second. You remember
that,
this.
About education. The second is that they are.
No, you forgot. Okay.
No.
You said first of all, I encountered this notion in the summer.
Oh, okay, that's what you were asking.
Uh-huh.
Second, I encounter in live democratic education when we visited for the first time the school, democratic school in near Harrisburg called the Circle School, and where we could actually see how this kind of education really functions. The Circle School is one part, is an American democratic school, and after the Summers Hill, there is a whole movement in the United States, and also around.
Started by whom?
Started by Greenberg. In the Sudbury Valley School, to organize similar education as NEO.
I don't think it's similar.
Why don't you think it's
similar? Because I don't think NEO ideologically puts stress on democracy at all. For him, it's focus was on therapeutic focus. And yes, it had an element of democracy, but It's, I don't think it was primary how he was thinking about it. For him, democracy was subordinated to therapeutic effect of the of having that school. For him, even education was not primary. It's kind of a therapy in a way. Mm-hmm. And in many ways, my understanding of Summerhill, that it was designed for kids that who had problems in like some of them would be problem in life, problem with conventional schooling, or problem that they might have like psychological problems or mm-hmm. mental problems or emotional problems and so on and so forth. So it was kind of therapy. It's a school therapy, I would say. Mm-hmm. When it came to the United States with the Sudbury Valley School, and you talk about Greenberg, who was writing about that, mm-hmm. The focus changed from therapy to democracy. Mm-hmm. And in the Circle School, and specifically talking about mm-hmm. our colleague and dear friend Jim Rittmuller, defined his school as a scaled-down democratic society. Mm-hmm. And so the idea is that the students experience in certain limited way, of course, like mini democratic society, which is the school is, mm-hmm. with key ideas that education cannot be and should not be, must not be imposed on the citizens of that society. Democratic, small democratic society. Mm-hmm. So kids, and by the way, kids rather than even students or children want to, or members of that society want to engage in some educational practices, it's up to them. And they can organize that. And the staff, if students ask for their help, mm-hmm. would school staff, they don't even call themselves teachers, it's a staff. Mm-hmm. They eager to help, of course, as asked.
And so, not only that, actually, it's not just kids ask and they answer. For many things that the students want to learn or to organize as activities for them, we could call them learning, but let's say music or science, they have to actually create small, they call them corporations, that would then make plans how this activity sure. will look. Sure. How it will be financed, how it uh-huh. will be organized, who is going to be leading it, what you would have in a corporation whose task is to organize a certain endeavor,
yeah. project. So it's not necessarily a whole thing is about learning, and not even about education. But again, it's kind of a society, a mini society, democratic society that the people live together and make decisions together and solve problems together. They say they have, like in Summerhill, when interpersonal problem involves, for example, the kids claim that other kids stole their property or toys or something like that. They had the call for the General Assembly meetings mm-hmm. in which they make decisions about that or discuss that.
Investigated, discussed.
Yeah. Creating new rules mm-hmm. and so on and so forth. In schools like in the United States, it's kind of different because they're more mimicking democratic bureaucracy, I would call, in positive or negative ways, like rules, laws, and whatever, mm-hmm. Constitutions, and judicial committees, and so on.
So instead of the whole assembly, they have a judicial
committee. They might have whole assembly, yeah. but it's become more about big issues, constitutional kind of issues, mm-hmm. or big issues in the mm-hmm. school. But day-to-day issues could be resolved within this kind of procedural democracy, organized, and deliberate democracy as well, but mostly procedural, organized by the special kind of judicial committees, as they're called mm-hmm. in the circle schools. And it's true that some activities, it's nothing to do with education, although of course they have educational, might have educational aspects mm-hmm. or learning aspects, and education and learning is not the mm-hmm. same. And sometimes students or children ask for specifically educational and learning a kind of endeavor, and yeah, which might involve, might not involve adults at all. Mm-hmm. Like, for example, we experienced children's, they were teenagers mostly at the circle school mm-hmm. club, book club, when they discussed books and trying to learn about these books and examine books. And no adults were allowed. Actually, we wanted to observe that, mm-hmm. and the children actually voted about that, and they allow us to be a part of them, and not just observe, but even participate in that. Mm-hmm. But it's up to them. But on the other hand, the children can ask staff to organize or be a teacher mm-hmm. for like to learning something in math or some other mm-hmm. areas, and that will be okay. And they usually put what we saw like a special, almost like a board, when we they create their classes on a regular mm-hmm. basis, and mm-hmm. some students sign up. And by the way, anyone can sign up who's interested in that. So it could be 5 years old kids, and it could be like 16, 17 year old teenagers, mm-hmm. and they can be together. Nobody will say, get out of here, yeah, you're too young yeah. for that. Yeah. If it's interesting, that's interesting. They can come and be part of that. Mm-hmm. Anything else you want to add about, the for people who don't know much about democratic education? And by the way, I want to say that my observation, because I saw some other school, democratic schools, they very could be very, very, very different among each other, which is mm-hmm. understandable.
Right. There are different flavors, like Neil's and the one that
you Yeah. For example, in Neil's situation, what he described, there were situations when kids threw away all the rules that were accumulated in the school, and they because the rules become rectified, they become like not understandable for reasons for these rules by the previous generation of the kids.
And these schools, some like Summerhill, are 70 years old.
No, I'm not 70 years old. In 2021, which is what, 3 years from now, it will be not almost, it will be 100 years old. So, but in other schools, they like to accumulate it, like American democracy, procedural democracy, they accumulate. Like we have constitution for 200 years, more than 200 years, mm-hmm. although things were aging, but they're not thrown away and started from the scratch. Mm-hmm. So there is a different ideas also about how much curriculum is imposed, not imposed, and so on and so forth. There is a lot of play that, especially for young kids, but not only for young kids that mm-hmm. can play on computer games or any other games.
Also, there is a difference if it's a boarding school. I'm not sure. The Sudbury Valley School is not boarding school.
It is boarding school.
It's boarding school. And Circle School is not a boarding school.
No, it's not boarding school. Yeah.
So there is always a difference what kind of issues and what kind of learning will happen in these two different types
of situations. And there is different philosophies. Very, very interesting. And I encourage them. Mm-hmm. So I think, I don't know if we have two people who are watching us.
I wish. It's you.
It's you.
And maybe somebody else besides
Because before
me.
It was zero. I don't know. Maybe it's just the system.
So if you're watching, send us a comment so you know who is watching.
Yeah. But I think we are ready to discuss, to compare with dialogic pedagogy.
But then let's briefly describe what's dialogic pedagogy.
So what the dialogic, since you initiative is Spanish, about how we in Russia would say. So what's
Well, dialogic pedagogy is
at least in your version.
Yeah, in my version, and you may not agree, you usually don't agree.
Yeah, hopefully I will disagree. I'm really looking forward for that.
Is an approach to education, not to organizing life, but to education that includes examination of students and teachers together, examination of critical examination, I would say, through a dialogue of self, the world, the other people, and the nature, and everything, and it's done through critical dialogue. So, in that sense, it's not so much something that's organized as a way of life as in a democratic school, but it's an approach of how in any examination thing people are organized to together think through things and agree, disagree, bring arguments for or against different opinions and the evidence for them, find out what they believe in or they what they are puzzle other people. So it's about really learning in the sense of really deconstructing and examining anything that is of interest to anyone. That's how I understand. It could be organized in different ways, in different schools. It could happen in dialogic, in democratic school or not. It could happen in other institutions, but every time it has a different, again, form. So it's not about the form. It's in about the approach, what education is. Mm-hmm. That's mm-hmm. how I understand the dialogic.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Again, your version of dialogue, because again, there are many different ideas we already mm-hmm. discussed mm-hmm. on many podcasts mm-hmm. about dialogic pedagogy. Let me continue, because I don't mm-hmm. think we need to discuss much dialogic pedagogy, but compare. Mm-hmm. And there is a lot of interesting, in my view, context between democratic education and dialogic pedagogy. And there are certain strengths in both of them, and I think there are certain weaknesses in both of them mm-hmm. Relative to the strength of others. So I, for example, I really admire dialogic pedagogy, but also democratic education, and learn a lot of from them. I'm trying to actually develop some kind of hybrid mm-hmm. between two of them. But let's go to the, maybe to talk about strength of democratic education. One of the biggest strengths of democratic education, which takes me a lot of time to understand. I think democratic, when they say democratic, it is more, I hear more like a metaphor rather than, exact term. Although there is exact term there as well, but I see more as a respect for human voice, specifically students' voice, mm-hmm. maybe even more important. And this is a remarkable thing, mm-hmm. in my view. And I think that voice is very different. There is a lot of ideas that the voice or the democracy kind of reply with the idea of autonomy mm-hmm. and people separated from each other, just like the irrational, mm-hmm. Like unrelated to each other, like atomistic individuals. I don't think this is what democratic education is about. No.
What do you mean separated atomistic individuals?
It's like autonomy again, that like they have to come to their own ideas, mm-hmm. uncontaminated by other people, or their own agency, uncontaminated by anybody else. Mm-hmm. It should be rational. It's like kind of, in my view, it has very Kantian and, in broader sense, Enlightenment roots.
When you talk about democratic education.
No, I'm not talking about democratic at all. I'm talking about autonomy.
Right.
And I'm just saying that democratic is not about that.
Okay.
It's about voice. Mm-hmm. And that's why this kind of hearing the voice of the students mm-hmm. and that voice decision making, deliberation mm-hmm. are very important in democratic education. Mm-hmm. And I can, and respect for voice, for, I'm missing Russian word for that, личность, which is not personality, but respect for...
not personality, person, just a person.
Respect for the person, which is very different from autonomy. Mm-hmm. It's not respect for autonomy from a person, because it doesn't matter how autonomous the person is. It's not about autonomy, being separated from other, but respect that the person has final authority to say something about themselves, like, for example, about to define their own education.
Yes. I think that there is a, we're constantly using two words that are very in the root together, but we kind of don't explicate how connected they are. It's not only final authority, but it's authorship. Authority.
Yeah.
So it's a respect for authorship.
All right. Yeah, thank you. That's very helpful. That's helpful. Yeah. It's kind of autonomy versus authorship. Mm-hmm. And I think democratically, I'm actually apologize. It's very inconvenient. I'm using that old camera because our new camera creating problem looks like on Facebook. Sorry, I apologize. That's why I'm kind of moving constantly to find better position. Sorry for that. But authorship is actually probably in opposition to autonomy. Mm-hmm. That's where the whole thing is coming. I think democratic education without, and again, we might need to check with our colleagues in democratic education. Maybe it's, I'm talking more about Jim, mm-hmm. since we know deeply each other. I think I hear more interest in this authorship rather than autonomy. But maybe I'm wrong. Maybe it is, or maybe it's something in between. But I'm more interested in authorship rather than autonomy. Mm-hmm. But I admire that because I thought that democratic education thought much more than everybody else, all other educational philosophies about this respect for authorship, especially mm-hmm. students' authorship, mm-hmm. and with their strong idea of non-imposition of curriculum on the students, mm-hmm. air education on the students. Yeah. I remember us coming to the Circle School, and we constantly asking about learning, and kids actually, and then staff say, like, why are you constantly talking about learning? And we said, like, this is bizarre. This is school. It's called school. So we have, but there, in my view, also democratic education coming closer to this notion of school as leisure. Mm-hmm. Is that this is leisure? Mm-hmm. It's a form of the leisure. So the kids do not need to work there, but it's a leisure. They can play, they can do many things. And education as part of the leisure, but not. Reduced to the leisure is not reduced to education. And I think that's a very deep kind of thing about that. Mm-hmm. And I admire, and I think, again, out of what I know, for me, that's like very excited and admired part of this democratic schooling is about this respect for the authorship and leisure, idea that school is leisure. And the idea as a type of leisure, mm-hmm. organization of the leisure, and idea of that that education has to be defined by the, it's a student's personal business. It's not societal business. It's not, society should not dictate when to study, what to study, with whom to study, and
whether to study,
and all these questions. Mm-hmm. And I've learned it from the democratic education, and keep learning that.
When you say leisure, the first, in today's world, the first association is that it's somehow time with no work, like empty time. Like you don't have any obligation, you're not busy, you're just kind of lying on the beach or something, doing what you want, which is not important or somehow. Because we connect work with job for others, with the chores and assignments of the, either by necessity to preserve our life or because we have to work for somebody else again.
You know, we discussed that issue.
Yeah, I know.
Not to get to that.
I want to say
there are a lot of other things. Let's not to get to that. Because we discussed that.
No, let me just finish my talk. Because leisure really is understood as a time when you can dedicate to yourself, for your own interests and imagination and growth.
You know, let's not go to that because you're opening the because it's not, what does it mean self? It's like, it's not egoistic. There's so many other issues there. Let's not go there unless people want us to go, and then we will have a separate. Because there are so many issues with democratic things. that we can discuss. Another thing that democracy also have, this is metaphor of democracy. And again, this metaphor is voice. Each voice counts, and the counts is not, each voice has to be heard, and it's for the voice of the person. Mm-hmm. But another part is political part. In this case, democracy is not a metaphor, it's democracy, power of the people. Mm-hmm. And in this case, it's also there in democratic education in Summer Hill, it's an assembly when they're voting for the decision-making, to pass the decision-making, and many other schools, all these democratic elements there. And also it's involved in American, especially schools, a lot of procedural democratic rules and like books like this with the rules and so on and so forth. And sometimes kids don't know even reasons for these rules. And I'm talking about not because I'm guessing that the kids don't know, because we ask, at least in Circle School and some other schools that I attended, kids, what's the purpose of this particular rule? And they say, we don't have. We don't have any clue. It was in the past. Mm-hmm. Yeah, someone created that. So anyway, that's another aspect, which is, in my view, less exciting. And in my talking with Jim, he also found that this is not the most important part of the, it's interesting because we had this, we brought Alexander Labok to his school, mm-hmm. and we had this, three of us, this conversation.
Who is Alexander
Labok? Alexander Labok is a Russian educator and philosopher of education, who is a psychologist, who is like very much dialogic, Bakhtinian in my view. And we had this discussion, and Jim agreed actually with Alexander that this rule and all of this kind of thing, voting, is not the primary thing. It's just a kind of conditions. It's not the spirit of the whole thing. And actually, I very much, my observation also going along with that, my personal observation of democratic schools. Let me tell that one paradox that I faced with democratic schools, which is actually brings criticism of them as well as admiration in the paradox. You know, I'm very much against this bureaucracy, including the democratic bureaucracy, when people have to follow rules.
Just because
there is a rule, whether or not it makes sense or not in this particular situation, or not knowing history or meaning of these rules. It took me a while actually to understand what these schools are coming from, why they're doing it like that. But again, that's, I can elaborate that after that if you're interested in that. Mm-hmm. What I'm completely shocked, each time I'm going to the school, especially Circle School, but it's actually not only in Circle School. Whatever school is organized, I'm shocked while I'm talking with the kids, and it could be little kids, big kids, middle school kids, like in between, how thoughtful they are. And by the way, of course, my observation not systematic and anecdotal, but, you know, I try to push these limits. I just pick up random kids, randomized, non-systematic style. Anyway, and I found that all of them thoughtful and critical and so on and so forth. So for me, it's still a puzzle. How come? Where is it coming from? Because this critical dialogue that in my view not very much present in the school, except on these assemblies, but these assemblies can be not very happen on the, like, in my understanding, maybe I'm wrong, on the that regular basis, like in Summer Hill. Summer Hill, I can see that much more.
They have, I think, every day in Circle School judicial
committee. The judicial committee is much, that's very different. In judicial committees, they try to define, is somebody violated the rules of the school, and what, if it's case, what punishment to give? That's the only two questions to the answer. That, first of all, that question preset.
Yeah.
And so, although, again, I admire thoughtfulness of the students there, I'm couldn't understand what it's this, that deliberateness and critical approach in the kids and articulation, where it's coming from. And this is kind of always a puzzle for me, a very interesting puzzle. And huge admiration for the practice, which I admit I do not fully understand. And specifically what I don't understand, where the kids learn this kind of critical voice that I hear? Because in my view, there is not much practice them. There is much more practice of them than conventional school, but not even in comparison with that. And many innovative schools, but still not as much as I might want. But nevertheless, the result is, it might be very beautiful, so I admire that. Another thing that I'm kind of, if you look at the academic activities, what considered to be academic activities in the school, they're not admirable at all. They're very, in many ways, what I observed, I was sitting on the lessons,
very conventional,
very boring, in my view, very alienated. Daniel Greenberg actually, in my view, bragged, I would consider that, about that, how conventional it is. And the idea behind this bragging is basically if kids want to study something, it doesn't matter. Pedagogy doesn't matter. It can be its most boring and monologic. It doesn't matter because kids are active to get to that. To some degree, I can relate to that, like attending some some conferences, professional conference. It could be extremely uninteresting, actually, presentation from point of view of how it's delivered as well as even how it's talked. And many people sitting there just sleeping. But for some other people who are really in that field, for whom it's really could be very, very important, they can come and say, this is brilliant presentation. And in my view, this is kind of reflection of this, who is actually, who provides that work of digging work of the learning. Is it like, if a person is kind of coming with idea to learn and huge desire for that, like it doesn't matter in a way. That's what Greenberg idea. I, again, disagree with that for many reasons. But first of all, not everybody is going to dig that. Another thing, that monologicity can be a very oppressive intellectually and even extinguish
I think there is a difference between what's considered democratic education that organizes lives and voices of people that you're talking about, but voices about the lives, about everything else that's going to the school, but not their voices within educational event. Democracy within the educational event is a condition for the critical thinking.
Yeah, and in my view, many of the people who work in democratic schools understand education very conventionally, either as kind of instrument. First of all, it could be instrumentally. Secondly, it's very like alienated skills, just bunch of skills that you need to learn. And other things on the kind of more interesting ways. But still, it might be that very conventionality of that. It's kind of socialization, creative socialization, like learning how to become a musician or learning how to do fishing. So kind of apprenticeship.
Certain areas that everybody wants to learn. I mean, not everybody, but kids and adults could want to learn, like how to become a musician, which is not critical dialogue. You actually do want to become a musician, the skill of playing the orchestra and everything else, but critically examine what this piece of music means.
Well, critically examining life and many other things, including education itself. And I'm not sure that this is where I think there is a problem with, Melissa, great, that's Melissa. Hi. You might join us talking about the democratic school and disagree with us about that. But I think this is where the coming short. I've heard some democratic school where the staff is not discussing any philosophical issue among each other in order not to rock the boat with each other. There are some other democratic schools, which is not the case, but there are some is. And for me, this is another thing, that adults feel, again, segregated in some ways from children. Okay, Jim might disagree with me and my democratic education colleagues disagree. It's because, but it might be it's the case that they separate because they're not, from what I saw at least, not trying to create something fun for themselves. They see it as a work. They're working for this school. And part of it should be work, no question about that. But it, in my view, it's part of it should be not work. It should be part of their leisure as well. And also, all of this philosophical discussion happen among the staff and rarely involve kids. On the other hand, it might not involve kids, but the kids somehow, if you're talking about the kids, you're amazed how thoughtful they are and how much they're reflective about there, but I don't know how much they really participate in discussions with staff about key decision making about like philosophy of their life.
Melissa's comment to that is maybe it's because they are given the space where criticism is allowed. Less authoritative discourse makes room for internally persuasive discourse to develop.
Sure, and this is amazing that that could be a wonderful hypothesis, Melissa, about that maybe it's only what we need to have at conditions. By the way, this is not necessarily true for all democratic schools, what we're talking about. Mm-hmm. I've actually observed some very oppressive democratic schools from my point of view, from my analysis, not only mine, my colleagues studied that. Catherine von Duke, studied that the oppressive democratic schools where exactly these dialogical discussions are not allowed. And it's not created safe environment for these critical things. But your hypothesis is very interesting, that addressing my paradox that I noticed that. It's very interesting.
But I think because of the approach in the democratic school, which allows for the critical, internally persuasive discourse in at least the circle school, where that criticism or critical deconstruction of everybody's thought, adults or child, is allowed, it's a value. And because that value...
And that's what I don't think it's a value. I disagree with that it's a value.
Okay.
It's allowed, but it's not value.
It's not promoted, but it's taken as a basis of life.
When I discuss democratic schools, I think that they're coming from something that I can call educational libertarianism. And it's educational, it's not necessarily political. Please do not necessarily, although of course there is some connection, the terms are the same, so there is some close connection. But I mean, and the idea is that, first of all, we should be neutral to values. And again, I'm not talking about all democratic schools like that, but I've heard this very strong, especially, of course, circle school. It's like that. Stay away from this kind of ideological debates and not necessarily encourage that critical things, but nevertheless, not definitely not inhibiting them either. It's just like, it's happened, but that's fine, but there's nothing. It's not a value. That critical thing is not a value.
But what is it? Because it happens.
It's happened. That's what I told you.
No. It's not a value in itself, but that it's appreciated? No, it's not. Actually, it could only, it doesn't have to be appreciated for the democratic education to be democratic education.
And it's not actively committing to that at all. So nevertheless, of course, in my view, my observation, why saying that, of course, democratic school very much involves in critique of conventional education and part of the society and so on and so forth. So there is that element of critique of conventional education. And that, but again, it's very contextual kind of critique and not necessarily involved in the idea of, especially in academic work. In academic work, again, such, sorry to people from gym and maybe others, to say it's extremely boring academic
thing. It could be.
Not as well, what I saw. No. Not as it could be. I didn't see anything interesting. Like, for example, kids organize their clubs, book club. Mm-hmm. That's terrific. Mm-hmm. And that's, I'm very excited about that. But I'm talking about like when the staff teaching something. And that's, it's a very conventional thing, what they do.
Yeah, they also don't know in many schools what happens. And it depends on staff.
I'm talking about what I observed. Right. And not only that, I'm talking about a certain ideological orientation of like people like Dan Greenberg about that. Mm-hmm. Who, and Neil talks about that as well. And Neil is a little bit more ambivalent about this kind of phenomena. Mm-hmm. He has the same thoughts that Dan Greenberg, or probably reverse, then Dan Greenberg probably took the seed from Neil and pushed it forward. Mm-hmm. About this idea that if students are interested in something, it doesn't matter how to teach them. Which is a half a big...
Right.
And again, even what does mean teach and learning is very instrumental, very monologic, endpoint-based. Mm-hmm. And so anyway, I have this issues with that.
Mm-hmm. No, that's in many ways, I don't know whether I can say it's true, because we really did not study a lot more about it that I think we should study, because we know you and I,
okay.
We know the circle school, but we don't know firsthand. Except maybe
I did a little bit more than you.
Probably yes, but I still think that maybe a huge variation.
There is huge variation
about
yes.
which we don't know.
Well, on the other hand, I'm trying to read about them, and mm-hmm. I couldn't find more exciting than I would say the three schools, which is Summer Hill, Sudbury Valley School, mm-hmm. and Circle School. Again, maybe something exists that I don't know, but from what I observe. I would say the three schools for me are highlights.
Yeah, I would say that what I would agree is that all three of them have something that puts them together, which may be what Jim Rittmulder described as this, how does he call that, development just on, it will happen organically. It will just happen if it's not suppressed. If people have freedom, and Neil also thought, if people are free, and freedom is very important, it will just blossom from themselves.
Yeah, yeah.
You just don't have to do anything much but to provide safety in life there and respect for the voice, and that's enough.
And this is what Melissa was mm-hmm. talking about, mm-hmm. I think. She wrote.
It depends on how students want to learn. I ask students if they want to learn conventionally or in different ways.
Yeah.
I also think that because most of the learning is not intentional, most of the learning is organic.
Yeah, mm-hmm. And this idea of organic, I think this mm-hmm. is what you're talking
yes,
about. Yeah.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. I personally challenge this idea of organic learning, but again, because why I'm challenging it, because it doesn't fit my vision of learning. Organic learning is for socialization, and I don't think that education is at core. It's about socialization and the practice.
Unless, Melissa, if you think maybe organic something learning becomes a byproduct of some very interesting activities for people.
Yeah, that's what I'm talking about. Right. But that's socialization in my view.
Mm-hmm.
Socialization is not, in my view, core of education. Again, some people disagree with that, but that's just my view.
Mm-hmm.
I'm like what Anne was talking about, I'm more like Socratic view of education about examining life. Mm-hmm. In broader sense of that.
But
well, deconstruction of practices, not construction of practices.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And that's a big difference.
Yeah, it's a big difference. And again, for me, the paradox of that is, although there is no focus on that, somehow, somewhere, it's happened in the many democratic schools, and it's amazing. Again, I'm always like to visit democratic school, just talking with the kids. Sometimes, okay, between us, it's much more interesting for me to talk with the kids than the staff.
We have another person asking this very interesting question, Tina Kuhlenberg.
Mm-hmm. Uh-huh.
Does Dewey represent organic learning?
No. doing not represent organic learning, but it represents progressive learning, of course, which is has to be designed. Mm-hmm. And he talks specifically, design is double psychologizing, what he called double psychologizing.
And what is that?
Double psychologizing, again, in my understanding, involves two things. First of all, society decides what students need to study, mm-hmm. what's important to study, and then that's first thing. The second thing, it creates a problem because that if society decides for the students something to study, what's the thing to do with the student? And for that, do you suggest kind of that design of double psychologizing? First of all, psychologizing is about understanding why and how humanity came to these important things that society wants students to learn. Like, for example, even math. Like, why is it, what needs in the society historically brought that to light of this curriculum, of this achievement, intellectual and whatever achievements of the civilization, you can call it. It's not even society, it's like big even thing. So that's first psychologizing. So on each things, each curriculum thing, you need to do this analysis, psychologizing of how humanity came to that, what subjectivity, human historical subjectivity led to that, and how it led to that. The second thing is kind of connect that to psychology of the child, mm-hmm. and find in the life of the child, where is that curriculum may be relevant, interesting, and so on and so forth. Mm-hmm. And so this is design, it's not organic at all. And actually, Dewey was making a point, again, this is my interpretation of him, that school exactly needed because organic learning is not working well.
Yeah, so that there is a whole design and a belief that you can teach every child anything if you find the right
thing. Again, that's less important than our conversation.
Right. Melissa also had a very interesting comment about the democratic schools are only as good as the people who are in the community. I also know of schools that call themselves democratic but are oppressive. Melissa says that democratic schools are only as good as the people who are in them. They are oppressive schools. I also know of schools that call themselves democratic but are very oppressive.
Which I know as well, Melissa. Mm-hmm. Catherine von Duke, our colleague, wrote about dissertation about that, one of the schools, mm-hmm. For people who want to learn about that more. Mm-hmm. In terms of the first statement, actually, I would like to agree with that. But again, I saw something that surprised me. I observed some democratic schools where, in my view, the people were not very interesting people. Maybe I'm wrong. Maybe it's my personal thought. But again, what's going on with the kids, terrific. By the way, it could be that they used to be interesting people there, but not anymore. Or the people who even here were interesting people for some time, but not anymore, or not with me, whatever. Mm-hmm. It's true, there is maybe combined possibilities. But I observed something that puzzled me. That, as I told, the staff was not very interesting, mm-hmm. But the kids were extremely interesting. Mm-hmm. And so that's puzzled me, which suggests the possibility that maybe your hypothesis that if you create right conditions, that may be it. It's mm-hmm. not about some kind of people, which is, again, I so much dislike this hypothesis, like personally, it's because I believe in people. And not in the institutions, not in the conditions. Mm-hmm. But who knows, maybe I'm wrong, despite my ideological inclinations.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so what about whether dialogic pedagogy can be oppressive?
Oh yes, of course it can be oppressive. Mm-hmm. I actually documented many cases of me being a very oppressive as dialogic educator. just I don't know, and as example of creating this, you know, this Socrates is very dialogic and extremely oppressive educator. If you want to study specific examples of that, we're actually again working with Anna Mikhail Gradovsky from Norway, and we're working on the book Bakhtin Buying for Educators, when we're bringing these oppressive cases. Again, specifically, I recommend to read my cases of oppressive dialogic pedagogy. Yes, so it can be very oppressive. Yeah.
I don't know if it's, if you could call it oppressive, because oppressive means that you that students don't have a way to move away, but maybe violent.
No, no, they cannot move away, because the dialogic pedagogy can be so powerfully oppressive because there's no a way. And the reason is not because it's not a way, you're imprisoned inside, not outside. And that can be more dangerous in a way than some other oppressive forms. So again, in my view, dialogic pedagogy can be very oppressive. Exactly, because it can be very personal, very, very penetrative, as Bakhtin would say. And it creates a lot of disruption inside of the people and outside of the people as well. So, no, I think that's
it. See, I remember one of our discussions with Jim Rittmulder from the Circle School, in which he was very against starting a critical dialogue with the child, as if it was terribly dangerous and oppressive inclination of adults to involve students, impose on them some questions that they didn't come up by themselves. So from the point of view of at least his democratic school, critical dialogue that starts from an adult is very oppressive.
Yeah, and again, in my view, there is some very important part of that concern, which is very good concern, and that's what we're talking about, oppressive dialogic pedagogy, because it can be unwelcomed. And but of course, on another hand, Jim, and I think we're talking about past Jim, because I don't think he's he would agree with that now. I think he changed his mind about that. He softened his position in many ways, and we can talk about that, how he softened that. But I think this, just because dialogic pedagogy can be oppressive, it doesn't mean that it should be dismissed, or critical dialogic pedagogy can be oppressive. It should not be dismissed. And finding this kind of right judgment about that, it's very important. And that's what I'm saying, that Jim moved to teaching critical thinking in his school. Which is, for me, it's very interesting how it's happened, because I don't know how it's happened, but what surprised me that he, I think, started for our dialogue, critical with us, among us, he started changing position. But how come his kids suddenly ask him, because this is what happened, kids ask him to, they want to have a class, academic class, on critical thinking, which is, for me, there is kind of some, talking about in this kind of not very visible interactive process going on there, which might have critical aspects without participants much noticing them, or valuing even them, but they happen. Or valuing and not valuing, it's kind of both ways. And very interesting, and again, I wish I had cloned myself and go and spend time there and notice it, because I don't understand how it's happened. Like, for example, is it strange that Jim was start doubting about this, his critique of critical, his rejection of this critical dialogue initially, it only to get impressed, and suddenly kids wanted that. The same thing, we challenged him about this bureaucracy of democratic procedure things, and suddenly kids wanted to abandon rules. I have sense that there is something from our conversation going to the kids. I don't know how. And it might go for the gym, and he might not notice that he's bringing, that the staff actually much more proactive in many ways than the claiming or that even appears, because I didn't notice that in their communication, but I didn't spend enough time to notice that.
Also, you know, it's a, we are constantly trying to purify whether the relationship starts from the child or from the student or from the educator. And
For me, that's not a surprise. It's synchronicity.
It's synchronicity.
With our dialogue. How come it goes to the kids and suddenly kids bring exactly time when Jim changes his mind?
I want to say, it's much more complicated who starts, how it starts, whether it comes from the students. It, obviously, it in this sense,
For me, it's not important. There is some kind of discussions going through exactly. that from staff, but I don't know how, and I'm not sure they're noticing them themselves. Mm-hmm. Tina asks some question.
Tina says, I think Buber influenced the dialogic pedagogy is sometimes too concerned with authoritarian caring, having oppressive effects in practice. So I'm not sure exactly that I understand when you say, Tina, Buber influenced dialogic pedagogy, what's authoritarian caring? Do you know what that means?
No, I don't know.
Can you write more, please?
I don't know what authoritarian caring is. The only guess, my guess is, like, talking about myself, that I'm sometimes want, like, for example, I'm sometimes want my students in past.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Melissa, in the meantime, says, as a staff member, I might invite a critical dialogue, but I would use a lot of discretion before deciding to do so, because the very initiation of a critical dialogue is conveying all kinds of messages to the student.
Yeah, that's what Jim was always concerned. Mm-hmm. Contamination. Well, living in my, and this is part of the, in my view, Kantian, this alchemistic view of the people. People, let me give this example. I have a dear friend, or actually we are, both of us have dear friend from Spain, Maria Candela Albacurque. And she always start like in past, she started a communication with me. I was like doing something in my office and she will come and she will say, sorry, and even sometimes outside of an office, says, sorry to bother you. And I told her, this was part of the joke, of course, but I told her, Maria, of course you bother me. Of course you bother. You're interrupting my life by coming. Mm-hmm. But that's more means to be a friend. The friendship is defined by interrupting. Mm-hmm. And it's legitimate. If you stop interrupting, we stop being friends. Mm-hmm. And so this idea of non-contaminate, not imposing, is wrong in my view. Some imposition is terrible, but some okay, it's some influence imposition. That's great. That's what makes us in relationship with each other. That's mm-hmm. something with your mind, you can share that. Yes, wow, you contaminate that person. Now that person knows and can think about that. And make certain changes life, certain things become more possible, less possible, whatever. Mm-hmm. Right, that's true. Mm-hmm. But that's part of the human life. And I think what I disagree with.
Is it okay? Is it?
That's what I'm saying, that's okay. And that's what I disagree with democratic school. No, it's with the whole democratic school idea. Again, not everyone concerned about that. I think Neil was much less concerned about that than, say, Sudbury Valley School of Jim or Melissa maybe. In my view, that's not the case. Is when, and then this is exactly what's important. If it's a critical, it's commitment to critical dialogue, it means you commit to alternatives. Yes, you might be ignorant of certain alternatives. Maybe certain things you don't know. Mm-hmm. But that's not a problem for critical dialogue, which is always limited. Mm-hmm. It's, by the way, that idea of covering and not engaging students something, it's actually bigger danger because this being locked in your own prejudice, your own ignorance, mm-hmm. and that might be a big danger, that so-called contamination or imposition. Mm-hmm. Imposition itself is not a problem. When it's non-negotiable imposition, mm-hmm. or it's, but it's non-negotiable, not honest imposition, mm-hmm. that's become a problem. Mm-hmm. Imposing is not a problem.
That's right. That's very interesting.
When people can negotiate it and move away from that. If you don't want to hear that, mm-hmm. goodbye.
Right.
And people should be free to do that. And democratic school is exactly about that. Goodbye. That's what I so much like about that. Mm-hmm. What I don't like is constantly concerned. It's almost like self-censorship. And that's what I don't like.
So, see, I think it's also a certain kind of like a maybe Western cultural distance that's different from maybe Eastern European cultural distance with other people. What, where you find the boundaries? Which I think
I don't think it's about that, because in conventional education, there is no problem of professors trying to socialize or enforce and impose and violently, non-negotiably impose their values on the students. So no, that this is, I would say, pedagogical, philosophical difference within the same culture of United States.
Yeah, but I was obviously in a conventional education, which is authoritarian, the authority does not care about the boundaries of the subject mm-hmm. or students. But in the democratic education, when you start to care and respect voices, then you do have to care about what the boundaries
and find the I don't think that, let's say, again, we can check on Melissa, but I don't think mm-hmm. she has concern about talking with her friends. So that will be not a concern for her. The concern was talking with the, she had this concern about with the students or kids.
We have a lot of interesting, So first Tina is clarifying her first comment. I mean, they are concerned with creating good relationship. I think Buber influenced the biology pedagogy people in the sense of being caring and sensitive to the students, but they have a teacher attitude of knowing truths, knowing what is best for the students, etc. And Melissa said, but there is a power difference between adults and students. And then Tina also said that you have written very good article about non-negotiability. So it is something about the quality of the relationships, really, and the quality of the aggressivity that we don't exactly always know what's happening in the democratic mm-hmm. schools. That kind of, what's the quality of this relationship in which things can happen?
Mm-hmm. No, let me address first Melissa kind of concern. Of course, I would say interesting issue that educational relation between the, let's say, teacher, whatever you call staff, doesn't matter, and the students or whatever you call them, children or members of the community, doesn't matter. It's different from friendly relations or collegial relations or whatever, some other relations. No question about that. Not only because they're children, that's not, let's forget about this kind mm-hmm. of paternalistic kind of thing. But I'm talking about like in education, like for example, I'm also careful about bringing my ideas in my class. And my concern is, and this is part of the concern that I share with democratic school, is students can uncritically accept my ideas because they think they are correct ones. On another hand, that doesn't preclude me to bring my ideas as not necessarily marking as mine, but as alternatives. Like, for example, talking in my classes, I might say some educators or some researchers think about this way. What do you think about that? So in this case, I try to block this possibility of my word as a word of the authority in the sense that this is correct way of thinking. But I'm bringing what ideas, including my ideas, as alternatives. Not only my ideas, but many ideas. And my ideas, in this case, I'm not censoring my ideas because of that. But I'm censoring that they're mine. On another hand, if the students ask what my opinion about that, I not shy to tell them that this is my opinion about or my view of the things and justify them, but also add them that it's, again, please do not accept it just because of mine or because I think it's correct one or it's truthful one. You might disagree with that and some other people disagree, and I bring maybe reasons why they might disagree with that mm-hmm. as well. So it's kind of the good concern about abuse of ignorance, mm-hmm. students' ignorance, which has actually happened a lot in Socratic dialogues when mm-hmm. Socratic abused his interlocutor's ignorance. and imposes his ideas as negative things, as non-negotiable, because nothing can be negotiated if you don't know how to negotiate and what alternative for negotiation. In this case, I agree with the certain deep concerns that democratic school has. I'm just saying that they're overblown, in my view, these concerns. And it's possible to address this concern without censoring yourself. And bring critical things to there. And on another hand, there is a good point about that, that bringing critical things that undermine students' dear ideas can be done very carefully in a sense and should be welcomed by the students. If they become not welcome, this is my latest view on that, that should be, that's not very good, not very kosher to do. And this is where dialogic pedagogy can become oppressive and cross the line.
See, Melissa says, I agree, but students in your class, meaning probably your and my classes, have chosen to come to your class to learn specific information from you. That's not the case in a democratic school day by day.
Just emotional. I wish, Melissa.
Most of our classes are prescribed in the
one way or another. Yeah. They might be, even when they have choice, they don't have, it's choice very limited. Yes, there are very few students, I would say, who come because they want to come to me or to learn this particular thing. But there are a lot of students who didn't choose that and they're forced to do it for one reason or another or something in between.
And also, you know, Jim used to say that we have a weird democracy in the cage, in a way, trying to create in our particular classes. But in his school, it's a free-range democracy.
Yeah, and let's stop on that and do that, because I'm so thankful, Jim. Let me put how he put that. Where you put it in a nice way. He actually called us benevolent dictators. And it took me, like, when I heard that, benevolent dictator. I was like, wow, that's not pleasant for me to hear. And yes, it's not pleasant. It's not Eugene pleasant, but it's true. And initially I couldn't understand what he means by that. But we're so honest. Well, we're honest, benevolent dictators. What I mean by that in our settings, unlike democratic schools, we kind of say, well, this is regime of pedagogical education. You can be this, you can be that. And students at time takes time for them to believe that it's true. But there is also, we have power to pull the rug off from the students and just say, whoops, goodbye, dialogic pedagogy. Because we have this institutional power, whether or not we want it or not. You know, yes, there is some students sometimes kind of take, they really realize that we're serious about that. But again, that seriousness, even our seriousness, is embedded in
institutional
power that tomorrow I wake up and suddenly I say, you know what, I think it's failed. Okay, back to the basics. We have grading and blah, 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 blah. And nothing stops me. Nothing stops me. And I think this is where we are caged. And because we're caged, whether or not we want it, and we need to take it very seriously, we're benevolent dictators, and we need to accept that, understand that, and address that to the student. We need to tell students, yes, we are benevolent dictators. Although, again, students sometimes almost like forgetting that or really accept that. Like, let me give one example. In my classes, students select what they want to study, right? There is curriculum map that we together developed with the students what to study. And there were some classes when they might say, well, Eugene, our choice is your choice. Just select something from us, for us. And I, well, if that's the case, I do that. And I did in one class, the topic will be this and that. And that's it. And they suddenly said, wait a minute, Eugene, you can't just do that. I said, what do you mean you can just do that? You asked me to choose the topic for next class, and I'm doing that. That's the topic. I said, no, you need to tell us why you're selecting that. Because that's the kind of practice to discuss why. Mm-hmm. And I said, well, you didn't tell me that I should do that. You said that it's my choice. That's my choice. And I said, no, it will not work like that. You need to provide us rationale why you're selecting this topic for a particular next class. Why do you think it's good for us to do that? And I did that. And I was like, wow, at least they really limit my benevolent dictatorship to some degree. That particular student, that particular mm-hmm. class, mm-hmm. but still it is there. And Jim is right, you know, like I'm personally so thankful to him for making us unpleasant, to disrupt our mm-hmm. comfort, mm-hmm. and to provide a little bit, bearing the gift of the something like surplus of vision, using Bakhtin's terms, to notice us that this is our conditions and we need to honestly and responsibly address these conditions mm-hmm. rather than ignore and pretend that we're not in Kumbala mm-hmm. and everything is democratic, dialogic, and blah, 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 blah.
Okay.
So, any other new questions?
We don't have any other new questions or okay. comments. We are about
well,
an hour.
Thanks a lot, Tina and Melissa. By the way, I think I don't think we addressed Tina's question, no? About this care.
Yeah.
That's on the previous. So can you move something?
I don't, I at this moment cannot find out how to see all the comments.
Sorry.
Yeah. But
something important. I actually read that very quickly, Tina, your message. Mm-hmm. Maybe not the in detail. Mm-hmm. But I think you're right about one of the kind of temptation for dialogic pedagogy, unlike democratic education, it's a huge temptation, is to think that we know better than students what they need to learn or whatever, do whatever, and how to do that. There is mm-hmm. still this baggage behind that. In mm-hmm. this case, I'm so like to have Jim sitting on the like on this one shoulder, so you can see that my shoulders. And Eugene, this is oppressive, and this is monological. He would not say monologic because it's not democratic part of it. This imposition, he would say, and I think he's right, and I think we should be. This is kind of part of the, I guess, colonization by progressive education coming from mm-hmm. and conventional maybe as well. Again. Yeah. So maybe thanks a lot for participation. Yeah. I think I hope the video works and there will be no of these disruptions.
I hope so too. Okay. Well, thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
See you next time. Week. Vote for our next topics. I'll post it.
Yes.
Okay. Bye bye.